circuit. That's right here.
Thank you. the line power play will get the first opportunity. Thank you. be able to get around the hit and get the shot off. Fitzgerald, but if it did, it could have gone in the net. That was a tough play there. Nice. nice play there. But the Whippers are not saying that the rebound is losing two shots. Good opportunity there by Waters creeping down the far side of the ice.
Thank you.
crush. Time of 116 minutes and 21 seconds. Barber, keep the crush. Keep the body at 16.4.
Packer. In this power play, remember, the only catch on this team.
Good God.
Yeah.
Device specified in profile. So, for my audio, where it says device, I have it as, good lord, I have it as microphone. What should it be listed as?
Check, check, 1, 2. Check, check, 1, 2, 3.
Test 1, 2, test 1, 2. Test 1, test 2.
Well, welcome back to the broadcast. If you're hearing us and you were on Twitter right now, you can definitely tell us about it.
Please send us an emoji.
Yeah, absolutely. send us a note or anything. Hopefully it'll be better for the second period. But the one thing that was good in that first period, Erica, I thought was Connecticut's game. I think for what this team is and what their expectations were coming into this year, they've gotten better every game. And that first period technically was a really good road period. They're not actually home. They're the home team. But they were blocking shots. They were not letting the Riveters get out of the zone early. And they got the early lead.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. You know, this is something that we talked about on broadcasts last year. The Connecticut team is a team that had a lot of upside last season, but didn't maybe have all of the potential and talent that they needed in one place. Whereas I think this season, the Connecticut team has a lot of pieces, but they came together a little bit later. And so with some of the international players and with certainly the veterans that they have, I think you're starting to see a team that, as Ryan Equali put it, is maturing right in front of our eyes. And they're starting to figure out what that Connecticut brand of hockey is. And I think you're absolutely right. We saw that on display in the first period.
For the Riveters, they had some moments very late in that first period. Grusha had a chance right on the doorstep, hit the post. As you say, you thought it went off the post, but right there, and Ryson was out of position for a second. And Grusha, last year she finishes that. This year, it's just the luck is just not there for her right now, it seems like.
It does seem that way, and I think that compared to the Connecticut team, where they're starting to put the pieces together, the Riveters, as we mentioned on the broadcast that maybe not everyone quite heard but you and I, we know that the Riveters have dealt with injury. They've dealt with injury. They have some new pieces, including a new head coach. And so I think that's really kind of been a part of the story there. So I think while they're still scrambling to put pieces together as with what they have, the Connecticut team is at more of an advantage because essentially they know what they have and now it's just building upon it.
Fitzgerald strong in the first period. That goal was not one of her fault. It was just another deflected shot. And that's one thing the Riveters have had a little bit of trouble with. Shots from the point that are getting deflected and ending up right in the crease and eventually get pushed in.
Yeah, and so, again, we know that this is a game that Katie Fitzgerald is really going to want to put on her best performance. I think you're absolutely right. There are some things that the Riveters have to clean up in front of Fitzgerald, but we have seen the Katie Fitzgerald that we know as Brickwall Fitzy for the most part. For this Riveters team, she's been able to stand tall in front of her team. Now it's up to the Riveters, all of those skaters, to be able to keep possession of the puck and really make opportunities. We saw that Alexa Grusha had that shot, looked like maybe it hit the post, just didn't get that. But you have to keep shooting in order to overcome perhaps what is a little bit of bad puck luck right now for the Riveters.
Yeah, absolutely. And the power play certainly had its moments. Of course, as I mentioned, they had maybe the best chance of the period that didn't go in the net. And we'll see if they can carry that over into the second period of play. So we got about 8 minutes or so. Erica and I are going to take a little bit of a break. The audio works. We're back in action. And hopefully everything will be tip-top the rest of the way. The Connecticut Whale lead at 1-0. We'll be back in about 5 minutes or so with the second period of action here on the NWHL live on YouTube.
45 seconds, I'd say. Yeah. So 90 seconds. By the way, real quick, what do you think of the Mets trade for Cano and Diaz? Patriots in the guard, you might need to talk again. I will be so mad. So mad.
I don't understand. I mean, you know, maybe 3 years ago, would have been a good trade. I don't know that. What are we going to do? Too early or too late? You know, and then we don't know what to do. Like, our game probably could have been something for RB a while ago.
Yeah, yeah.
And welcome back to the broadcast here live on YouTube. We're about 90 seconds or so away from the start of the second period here. Nina Rogers is the only goal of the first, and the Whale lead the Riveters by a score of 1-0. Miri Rison celebrating a birthday, also celebrating somewhat of a homecoming. Of course, she went to Robert Morris University. You were at the Penguins game yesterday with another famous member of Robert Morris, of course, on the coaching side, and one of the great players in NWHL history, Kelly Steadman.
That's right. Steady. I got to do this, see Kelly Steadman at the game. Didn't get to see the Steady Celly, which those who remember the 2017 or 16 All-Star game here when she beat Hillary Knight for the accuracy competition. Like right down to the wire. That was probably one of the favorite NWHL moments that I was able to witness live, and it was right here at the Lemieux Sports Complex.
Kelly Steadman played it. One of the first games I ever did was Riveters Buttes, and it was the first time I ever watched her play. The Riveters won the game in a shootout, but Steadman did everything humanly possible to put Buffalo on her back to lead them to a win. It was a tour de force performance, and she was certainly really fantastic in that game, and certainly missed here in this league, but she's going to able to bring that knowledge to whoever she's coaching throughout her career and going to make those players even better. So wanted to make sure we got a shout out to her.
Absolutely.
Certainly, and one of the greats.
Yep, and she's at Mercyhurst now, which is her alma mater.
So the face-off here to begin the second period as the Whale are going from right to left on your computer screens, and the Riveters doing the opposite from left to right and opening icing just 10 seconds in. And the Riveters will have an offensive zone faceoff coming up.
And so we were talking about it as we were going into the intermission. Connecticut really had the better play in the first period. The Riveters going to want to pick things up. And knowing that, again, they've been hit by the injury bug a little bit, let's see what the players that are here in Pittsburgh can do.
Picard off the faceoff and a clean one there from Grushow. Tries to find Dench, and now Grushow gets it back. A pass was deflected and easily picked up by Connecticut's Barabeau, and she'll move it up where Zadie will regather. Dench tries to push that one forward, and it's intercepted, and Martian gets it over to Goldsmith. Goldsmith with some space now, gets around Zadie, takes a shot in, and a save made by Fitzgerald. Able to hold on to that one. 35 seconds gone by in period two. The Whale still leading it by one.
Able to talk to Jamie Goldsmith as well as Michelle Picard, captain of the Riveters. Both participated in the juniors tournament that was just before this game, Matt.
Mirzova wins the faceoff clean, and Rogers going for her second goal has a shot blocked. Aide and Rogers. Little pitch and catch there. And it's Packer, has to go off the boards, and Lawler, chance for a two-on-one. Russo down the middle. Lawler drives, pass across, and it's by the side of the net, and it did not go. Lawler tried a very late pass and almost knocked off the skate of Rison and into the net. Russo able to outrace Fluke for the puck, but Emily Fluke does not give up easily. The captain sends it across. Mirzova tried another pass. That would have been a tic-tac-toe goal for the highlight reel, but it just did not get through to Rogers at the side of the net. Burke is slowly coming off the ice, and Packer gets taken down. Mirzova went down with her. Play will continue as Burke again slowly still gets to the bench, finally getting there, and she is in a lot of pain. Icing is called, and we'll have to keep an eye on Courtney Burke right now, who is on a knee on the bench and being looked at by the training staff.
And you saw her mixing it up with Nina Rogers, not just on that last play, but even before then. Rogers giving her a little stick business there. I'm not sure if she got caught maybe around the hands or somewhere else, but as you mentioned, she came off of the ice in a lot of pain, and we just talked about how Courtney Burke came back into this lineup to see her potentially be out even just of this game as the Riveters find themselves down is probably not a place Randy Velischek wants to see his team in.
Third line for the Riveters out there now. A couple players bump into each other. Lewicki had a nice period, I thought, in period one out there for the first time here in the second. And good pressure. Morse able to keep in for the moment, but Aide will calmly get it to center. But a good pressure again from Morse. Rebecca Morse, kind of the Swiss Army knife of players in this league, can play defense, play forward, can do a little bit of everything and does it all very well. Dostal will chase after. Mirzova putting the pressure on the veteran. Here, Dostal has played the most games in Riveters history, has never missed a game in the 4 years the Riveters have been in existence. Lewicki from not far from here in West Virginia takes a shot too high over the glove of Raisinen as Lewicki gets another opportunity. Puck sent across and will be dumped in. Icing waved off and Picard will get to it first. 17-39 and counting to go here in period two. Connecticut holding onto that slim 1-0 lead. Pass off the boards was intended for Richards, is intercepted, and the Riveters will regroup. Puck goes off the boards, and Ryson will play it right at the side of the net. And the Whale trying to move it up, and they will at least get it to center, forcing the Riveters have to get back onside. Turnover in the neutral zone. Houston, 1-on-4 now as the Whale go off for a change. Here in the second period, the changes are a little bit different here. And again, the Whale get to make that last change after whistles because they are the designated home team. And we will have an icing with 17:03 to go. The Riveters and the Whale, the long change in this period.
And just taking a look across from us, Matt over at the bench, looks like Courtney Burke is still there on the bench, kind of bouncing around, trying to get a feel back from whatever was ailing her. So I guess it's a good sign she's still on the bench and hasn't made her way to the locker room.
Remember, the Riveters are without Colzer. They do have Morse here. So if they were to fall behind by a defender, they could put Morse on the blue line and just play with one forward short, maybe double shift someone if it comes to be. Centering pass out in front, save, and a rebound was there for Lovenjelm, but she could not get a stick on it. Big save by Fitzgerald, who has been strong since that early goal. Riveters.
Two big saves there, excuse me.
Try to get it out of the zone. And Richards, oh, almost had a breakaway there, a breakout. And Zadie calmly sends the puck across the bench. Ryan and Zadie out there now with Burke still dealing with that injury. We'll see when she gets back onto the ice. That'll be the real calming factor for Riveters fans with Burke already having dealt with an injury and missing games earlier this season when she gets back out there. But it's Zadie and Ryan partnered up for now. Mirzova tries to dance around Ryan, has the puck hop on her, and eventually sends it in where Fitzgerald will just stick it away into the corner and the Whale will go off for a change. Puck sent across, Ryan sends in deep behind the net. Raisinen waits for the defender to get back, and Elena Orlando is that defender, and she'll just immediately turn it back over as she clears the zone. Dostal from Slattery. And Lawler pushes it up to Russo. Russo had to wait for it as it was a slow-moving puck and tries to send it across to Packer, who was just out of her reach. 4.5 minutes gone by. As again, Doyle and Packer bumping each other into the boards. Not the first time that's happened, and probably won't be the last either. Lawler knocked it down, but it still got out of the zone. And Goldsmith able to push it forward. Here comes Beatty. Beatty winds, fires, and the save made by Fitzgerald. 15-16 to go, still 1-0 Connecticut.
Already we've seen Connecticut really be able to take it to Katie Fitzgerald, but she has not relented as of yet, Matt.
And this is a big start for Fitzgerald. Little bit of a goalie controversy, maybe. Randy Velichek did say that Sask was the reason why they won last week, in his opinion, and certainly has been coming on. So Fitzgerald, the grasp on the starting job might not be as strong as a lot of people would assume, but playing well today for sure. And we'll see what the future holds for the goaltending competition between Fitzgerald and Sask as the season continues.
Upside of that is you have two goalies ready to go.
Absolutely. Certainly saw a two-goalie system work in Buffalo a few years ago, and it's working now. Richards moves in and has it stick check from behind. Great defense, and you can hear the players on the Whale bench loving what Jordan Brickner did, but they won't love that penalty coming up as the Riveters will go on the power play for the second time, and it's going to be for body checking.
Looks like Audra Richards was the recipient of said body check. But absolutely, we've seen this Connecticut team really is an aggressive team. They have good size and good speed, not overwhelmingly in either category, but enough to really play an aggressive type of hockey that we saw a little bit last season. But again, I think they have the personnel to play that style of hockey.
So Tiberi goes off to the penalty box. Riveters are 0-1. The power play struggles have been evident throughout the season. They've been written about, talked about. The Riveters just want to get a goal and just shake it off. We'll see if they can do so here and try to tie this game up. Burke is back on the ice. Moves in. Takes a shot. Just wide. Russo tried to get it along the goal line, but could not. Ryan sends it down to Russo, who tries to get it back to Packer and does. Packer, oh, that's going to come out of the zone. Bad pass there from Madison Packer. And Burke will regroup at center, and the Riveters get onside. Russo moves in. Russo goes wide. Goes to the front of the net, takes a shot, save. Rebound along the side of the net. Stopped again by Raisinen. Packer back to Burke. Burke, so patient with the puck. A great power play quarterback. Sent down low to Russo. Pass out in front looking for Lewicki. And Raisinen's able to dive out in front of the crease to make the stop. 106 to go on the power play. 13:52 to go in the game with Connecticut still up 1-0.
Really have to give some props to Mehdi Raisinen as Rebecca Russo was right there on the doorstep, poking at that puck. But Raisinen, she had that post covered and was able to come up big again for the Connecticut Whale.
Dostal, as the second unit power play comes on the ice, Dostal and Zadie. Dostal with room. Zadie takes a shot. Oh, good glove save by Raisinen. That might have deflected right off the top of the glove there. Zadie was going top shelf. Gets it back again. Now Dostal. Dostal waits. Takes a shot. Deflected. And another save by Raisinen. Grushow was in front. So was Richards. Randy Velischek told Erica and I that Richards is going to be parked in front of the net. Certainly a good screen there from Richards, but Raisinen made the stop. Richards has it taken away, tries to swing at it and missed. Beatty tries to get it out but could not. Played back to Dostal. Dostal winds, takes a shot too high over the crossbar. That was a rising slapper that just missed. Fluke will bring it out to center and will kill off some more time as there's 18 seconds to go. Riveters are getting shots and that's what the coach wanted and it's what we talked about pregame. Turnover, Mirzova gets bumped though. That was a good bump, if anything, from Russo. To stop Mirzova from coming in shorthanded. Remember, she had a shorthanded goal last week. The power play is over. The Riveters are 0-2, but Richards moves in. Richards on the backhand, goes wide. Tries to go around, centering pass, but nobody home, and here comes Connecticut. Lovenjelm brings it across, and offsides is the call. 12:35 to go in the second. 1-0 Connecticut still in front. Erica, chances there for the Riveters, but the Whale also had a scary moment on the penalty kill, able to get a turnover, but could not turn it into a shot.
That's right. I mean, we're just, again, seeing Connecticut really be able to take opportunities to be aggressive. They're being extremely aggressive, and the Riveters are not able to get any kind of momentum in this game so far.
Burke moves it up ice, finding Russo, now Lawler. Lawler sends it back past the Russo, and now Russo behind the net has it taken away, but Lawler gets it back. Erica Lawler certainly has got some great jump to her game, especially the last two since being moved back to center. Ryan has the shot deflected, but Packer able to get it back. Packer thought about Ryan, decided to get it down to Russo instead. Russo will shovel it along, and it'll be Lawler to get it back, but turns it over. And Menegan able to spin away from Burke, tries to get to the loose puck. Barbo is driving right down the middle. They were able to get a pass off, could have been a great chance, but the Whale could not. Burke trying to get a hold in the stick call, but does not work out. And Packer moves it up. Saucer pass over to Russo, but Russo, out of gas on that shift, comes off the ice to make a change. Riveters nearly get a turnover, and a shot in, actually, or a loose puck in on Rison, and had to stick it away.
That's Armbrust sticking with that puck there to give the Riveters another opportunity.
Puck hops at the blue line, but stayed in. Dostal takes a shot, save made by Rison, and Armbrust goes into the corner to play it. Armbrew has it taken away, and the Whale having trouble getting it out of the zone. Cannot get it out again. More stick handles down the boards. Backhanded pass nearly hits the referee and goes around, and Lewicki will get there first. Tiberi on her. Lewicki tries a little behind-the-back pass, and now Dostal falls down, and here comes the Whale with a two-on-one. Mirzova, Rogers driving. Mirzova gets a pass back, tries to get it to Fluke. It's knocked down, and here come the Riveters.
Great job of Lewicki to get back there and give some help to Fitzgerald.
Armbrew moves in. Dostal takes a shot. Save made, and Raisinen with a little flash from the Finnish netminder holds on to it. 10:47 to go. It's still 1-0 Connecticut.
I think we saw in that last sequence there that both teams really able to take advantage when the other is making mistakes. And it's really going to come down to if the Riveters can get an equalizer, as we would say in soccer, and then who can really clean up their play going the rest of the way.
Grushat with the faceoff against Lovenjelm, and Lovenjelm is kicked out. So Menegan takes the faceoff and wins it. But Richards able to get to it, loose in the slot. Oh, it goes across the crease, but no Riveter was there to knock in the tying goal. 10:35 to go in the second period. Still 1-0. Connecticut in front. Riveters have had great chances here in this second, but haven't been able to finish. Richards goes wide, moves in, has it taken away. Great defensive play once again by the Whale. Picard able to keep it in the zone, takes a shot. Deflected away. Richards sends a hard shot across the crease. Zadie pinching in. Sends it across, save made by Ryson. It's still loose. Ryson, I don't think, saw that second shot, but able to make the pad save and cover in the crease with 10:12 to go in the second.
Yeah, that was a great defensive play by Houston for the Connecticut Whale there to disrupt. I believe that was Audrey Richards coming down there, Matt. And again, just we're seeing both teams. I think the game has picked up, I would say, since the first period, which is exciting. It's exciting hockey we're seeing right now.
Burke takes a shot, deflected, blocked, and now Packer has it. Packer behind the net, tries to get away from Martian, does and gets it over to Lawler. Lawler on the backhand has it taken away, and Goldsmith's got it. Now Orlando will just dump in deep, and the Whale will get the forecheck started, but the Riveters won't even allow that to begin, as able to move it up ice. Lawler has it, but trips on her own skates there. And the Whale swinging at it a couple times, just trying to get it in deep. And Goldsmith finally able to do so with a little bit of help from Barabow. The Whale will go off for change, and the Riveters will have a chance to get it out of the zone. Next whistle have the media timeout. Pass across to Russo. Lawler driving. Russo stick handles her way through, but could not get past Brickner. Puck played behind the net, and to Barry with a bouncing puck, able to control it for a moment, but the Riveters putting on the pressure. And DeBerry gets it back. Rogers from Dostal. Rogers, the only goal in this game so far, came just past the 3-minute mark of the first period, and that was it for the scoring. And there is an icing call against the Riveters, so the Whale will have an offensive zone faceoff coming up, 8:56 to go. And because if it's an icing, we will not have the media timeout just yet.
And you wonder there if the Riveters maybe could have gotten a pass through. He had a few forwards that were up rather than kind of dumping that puck and giving an opportunity now for a faceoff in the Whale offensive zone.
Faceoff won by Merzova. There's a shot in and a save made by Fitzgerald. That might be one of the first shots the Whale have taken in this period. It has been Riveters controlling the puck, but haven't been able to beat Ryson in just yet. Ryson had her arm up, thought there was an icing call, but that was waved off immediately. As Morse tries to control it. Whale able to at least get it to center, and Merzova, who looks up ice, waits, and now makes the pass over to Lovenjelm. Fluke able to hop off the ice quickly as the puck was right near the benches. And it'll be sent down, and the Whale will recover and will look up ice, does Orlando. Coming up on the 8-minute mark here of the second period, 8 minutes to go. And the Whale still holding on to that slim lead. Menegan pushes in, gets taken down by Grushow. Maybe the Whale bench wanted a penalty on that, but no arms were up and play continues. Puck sent over to Orlando as it was just out of the reach of Grushow. And now both teams having trouble sustaining some zone time here. Puck is sent all the way down. And another icing, and the timeout will have to wait as the Riveters will have an offensive zone faceoff coming up.
Again, we're seeing a little bit of a different pace, I believe, in this second period. But I don't think we've really seen any consistent, controlled puck possession here yet from either of the teams in the last several minutes.
Packer. Had it and tried to get it over to Burke. Battle for it in the corner. Packer gets taken down, but no arms are up, and the play will continue. Ryan able to keep in the zone. Sends in a soft shot into the corner, and Packer will get there first. Packer tried a backhanded pass to Russo, but it did not work, and the Riveters will regroup. Burke sends it to an open space that Ryan will fill with the puck. Ryan moves in, down the middle, takes a shot, and it's easily blocked away by Raisinen. Burke gets it back at the blue line, moves to the left point, takes a shot, deflected just over the mask of Raisinen, a little bit too high. Packer chases after the puck, so does Lawler. They meet along the boards with Beatty, trying to dig it out. Dostal able to keep in the zone. Dostal sends a backhanded pass over to Lawler. Lawler tried to send it in on net, but the Whale were the only players there, and they will move it up ice. Slattery has it, or will have it in just a moment, and she makes the quick pass over to Richards, bounces off the boards, and Grushow. Grushow gets slowed up for a minute by Mirzova. Now the puck ends up off the body of one of the Whale players, and Richards is able to get there. Dench. Dench. Centering pass across. Could not get Grushow. And here come the Whale. Rogers looking for her second. Makes a pass over to Fluke, but Fluke just a little bit behind the play there. But able to find Brickner. Brickner takes a shot. Deflected save. Rebound. They score! Right off the shot by Brickner, the save by Fitzgerald, and Mirzova does it again! Her fourth goal in three games against the Riveters, and at the 6:08 mark of the second period, it's 2-0 Connecticut!
That took a big bounce off of the pads of Katie Fitzgerald, who made the initial stop, but Mirzova was right there on the doorstep, able to bang that away, and the Connecticut Whale, the home team, now have a 2-0 lead over the Riveters. We've got about 6 minutes to go in the second period, excuse me.
That is a big second goal for the Whale, as they now have a 2-0 lead, and they'll look for more. That was just a simple little play. Brickner got room, took the shot, and got the rebound, and Mirzova was right there. Morris's shot goes through the crease, and Miri Raisinen is having herself quite the birthday. 5:45 to go. She is shutting out the Riveters right now and has a 2-0 advantage. Let's see how the Riveters can respond to giving up that goal, now falling behind by two. Again, no Colzer, no Kessel, no Nash. Three big players out of the lineup from last week's come-from-behind win against Connecticut. The Whale shed no tears about that. That's for certain, though. Puck played by Grushow, and Morse tried to clear the zone. It's blocked off, and the Riveters will try again. And Morse has it. They give the assist to Rogers and to Brickner, so if that is correct, Rogers has a goal and an assist in this game. Richards tries to push it forward. It's going to go to the blue line, but kept in. Good job there by Ryan to keep it in. Puck shuffles along the boards, along the shelf on the boards, I should say, and Richards will get to the loose puck first. 4:30 to go here in the second period. Riveters down by two. Ryan's shot blocked into the corner. Dench, now Richards, gets a little help from Dench, and Dench has it. Dench sends it back to the blue line. Burke takes a shot, did not get all the way through. Another shot blocked by the Whale, and Orlando can't get it out of the zone. Good keeping by Burke. Riveters make a change real quick, and they'll stick handle as Packer has it, but then lost it. Great job there, excuse me, by Beatty to at least get it to center. Riveters complete the line change, and as that top unit for Metropolitan has hit the ice, Packer, Russo, and Lawler. Russo tries to pass it over to Packer. Now Lawler ends up with a loose puck. Slattery over to Dostal. Dostal down low. Pass across, a shot pass, I should say, from Russo. Finds it on the stick of Slattery, who popped it up in the air. And now Lawler down the Packer. Packer. Russo tried to take a shot, and she missed it. Dostal shot, and another save by Rice, and the puck was loose for a second. But Beatty sends Packer away from her netminder with 3:28 to go in the second. The Whales still lead it 2-0.
I got to give a shout out to Lawler, another Erica. Erica to Erica Love here. That was a great play that she had along the boards to keep that puck in and, again, give the Riveters another opportunity. And then you see a little bit of a mix-up in front of Weissenen, her teammates trying to protect her. You need to see more of that from the Riveters going forward in this game, getting aggressive, really keeping the puck in the zone and giving their teammates opportunities in front of net.
So we have finally hit that media timeout with 3:28 to go, probably one of the latest media timeouts that we have had in the league, at least this year. So right now for the Riveters, down 2-0, and this has been a period that they've controlled the play for the most part, but the Whale are just keeping them to the outside.
They've controlled it in pockets, but as we see, once the Whale have an opportunity, they're really, I think, just a little more sharp with their opportunities. And we talked to Randy Velischek about that a little bit. He felt that his team needed to be a little bit more sharp when they have the puck, when they have opportunities, in this case and for the last now going on 3 weeks in front of Räisänen, and that just hasn't happened.
See what the Riveters can come up with here. You got to figure the next 3 minutes, if they can get a goal on the board, they will feel a lot better about their chances going into the third period than they would trailing it by two, especially with the way the Whale have been very sound defensively for the most part in this game. They are blocking a ton of shots. We don't have shot totals here inside the building. They're not keeping track of them on the scoreboard. But I got to tell you, the shot attempts have got to be heavily in favor of the Riveters. The problem is they're not getting through on net.
And again, you mentioned it in there. You have to give credit to this Connecticut Whale defense and just overall the team really getting in front and getting in those passing lanes and not really giving the Riveters much of a look on Räisänen.
So face-off to the left of Räisänen in the right-hand circle by the way of our broadcast was shot in and a save made as Richards quickly took that shot off the face-off. As the starting lineup for the Riveters out there now, Grushow, Richards, and Dench. And the pass across is deflected into the neutral zone by Rogers, who has a goal and an assist in this game. Zadie sends it across. They try to quickly get it to Richards. It was deflected, and Richards, though, able to quickly get to it and move it over to Picard. Rogers, good job there to intercept. Tries to clear it down, and Dench chasing after the loose puck won't get there first.
Rogers has been just a menace to this Riveters team today.
And certainly has been strong as that third member of that top unit for the Whale with Lovenjelm and Mirzova. This time it's Mirzova, Fluke, and Rogers, who played together in the first game and did get some time in game two as well. Mirzova brings in the zone, has the second Whale goal in this game. Pass across, and Russo tries to get there and has it taken away. You just got to wonder the frustration level for the Riveters in this game, where it is right now. Packer has it across the blue line, got some space, moves in. Pass across looking for Russo, but it was just out of the reach of Russo as she was driving to the net.
Want to go to that frustration level in a minute here.
As Houston brings it in, but has it taken away, and Packer will cross the red line with 2 minutes to go here in the second.
If the Riveters are frustrated, that's fine, but they have to find a way to now utilize that in a way that's going to be positive and get them back on track to what they're trying to accomplish. Not only overall in getting a win on the road, essentially, but overall in how they're playing and getting to Riveters hockey. So frustration, whether it has to do with how the game is being officiated or anything else, how is the team going to overcome that? That has to come from the veterans, the leadership, and really every player on the ice making a commitment to stick to the game plan.
Richards plays it into the corner. Grushow and Dench there as well along the near side boards. As we come up on 100 seconds to go here in the second. Can Riveters get it back within one before the period ends? Ryan sends over to Burke. Back to Ryan. Ryan's shot deflected into the corner, and Richards sends it back to Burke. Burke thought about a shot, waits, now shoots it, and again it's blocked. And it's going to be cleared out of the zone. And Houston has it, gets it to the red line, and sends in deep. Grushow back for it. Lovenjelm, the only Whale player on the forecheck there. And Richards has it. And patiently looks up ice, finds Ryan. Ryan moves in with space, takes a shot. Räisänen in the save. Oh, rebound was there. But she was in control the whole time and is able to cover with 1:06 to go.
Mia Dench comes in strong, gets a little bit of the business from that Connecticut team. But good on Dench to drive hard to the net. I think sometimes we see a player will take a shot for the Riveters, and there's not too many players around to really kind of pick up any rebounds or a puck that might get loose from Bison, and that's a little bit more of that, you know, gritty hockey in front of net that the Riveters kind of are missing right now, I'd say, Matt.
Well, make a late change as they see what the Riveters were doing with bringing out their top line of Lawler, Packer, and Russo. Faceoff won by the Riveters. Lawler has it, backhanded shot, and Raisinen quickly covers. And Packer, after Russo took a little chop at Raisinen, as Packer and Doyle exchange pleasantries once again. And it looks like Russo, for that chop, is going to be sent off. Referees having none of it, and Rebecca Russo, with under a minute to go here in the second, will be sent off, and it'll be a power play for the Whale, and that is part of the potential frustration that we talked about.
Yeah, absolutely. Not necessarily the positive effect the Riveters might want, but let's see what they can do. Now they're down a player, and they really need to get some momentum back.
See if the Whale can do here in the final minute of the second period on the power play. Their second one of the game, they're 0-for-1. Puck sent down and Lawler chasing after it. Doyle getting there, and it will be Doyle to get there first.
That was quite a race.
So Shannon Doyle, a slashing call. Oh, Doyle whiffed on the first pass attempt, but no harm there. Lovenjelm brings it across the blue line. 35 seconds to go in the second period. Whale will have a minute and 2 seconds on a power play if they don't score here in the next 30 seconds. Fitzgerald sees that one sticked away. And Picard tries to backhand it out of the zone, but it's blocked. Mirzova does a good job keeping it in the zone. Gets it to Lovenjelm. Lovenjelm with room. Waits, very patient. Lawler puts on the pressure now, and now Mirzova. Back to Lovenjelm. 10 seconds to go. Shot deflected loose in the slot, and Lawler doesn't get everything on it, but does enough to get it out of the zone. Lovenjelm with the pressure from Dench, and with 3 seconds, 2-1, that will do it. For the second period of play, the Connecticut Whale get a goal from Katarina Mirzova. And at the end of two periods of play, they lead the Riveters by a score of 2-0.
Mirzova, we talked about it earlier, but we'll say it again just for good measure. We talked about Mirzova and what she's been able to do for this Connecticut Whale team, and we see it again. We see it again here. We also talked a little bit earlier about how Katie Fitzgerald gets the start here, but that Randy Velischek, you know, might be looking to be a little bit more equitable, perhaps we can say, with the time for the goalies in net. Now, I don't know that I put everything necessarily on Fitzgerald. There are a lot of things that are happening in front of her, particularly opportunities or lack thereof offensively that are not quite coming together for the Riveters. However, with that said, if that is the case and if that's going to continue to be a trend, then you do want to make sure that you are solid in net. So I don't know. It sounds like, or it seems like, in this third period we have coming up, and then for the remainder of this season, that there's still some questions that remain for this Riveters team.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's going to be kind of a gut check period. This is a big game. Boston's taking care of business in Minnesota, or at least the last time we checked. We don't know exactly what the score is. We'll look at that during intermission. But they're on the verge. They were leading going into the third period against Minnesota, or at least I thought they were. And if they can get a sweep here, Boston's making a statement. Minnesota already has swept the Riveters this year. Buffalo hasn't played an NWHL game in a while, but they are certainly a strong team. The Riveters lose today. They find themselves in fifth place with one game to go before their winter break, and they have to play that Boston team next week. So this should be an interesting 20 minutes coming up for the Riveters. We'll have intermission for about 15 minutes or so. We'll be back with the third period of action here. This is the NWHL Live on YouTube.
know what that means. I was like, is he talking about the audio? Like, we were trying to engage with people.
Now shooting. Now shooting. Go away.
Can't make a joke.
Oh, dear. Come on, dude.
Now shooting.
Excuse me.
Oh, fine. Whatever.
Now shooting. Warren, win.
So much so.
Now shooting. Here, Rudy.
See ya.
Now shooting. Magnolia, Auburn.
Frustration.
It's 5-2, Boston.
Ooh, what the heck is going on? I love it. I think people underestimated Boston coming into this season. It's going to make for a really interesting second half.
Krizova, I think is how to pronounce it, scored a power play goal. And then Souliotis got it, made it 5-2.
Oh, nice. Now, I think it's Shishova. Denisa Shishova. In the locker room, because they're like posted out here. They said that at the, was it the first game in New Jersey or the second one, where the players were like coming out and just like buckets of sweat. They wouldn't even stay in the locker room. I think it was the second one.
Oh.
Yeah, because Burke was there.
It's going to be one long bus ride home if they don't rally. We talked about the Boston Minnesota game. They're 5-2.
Oh yeah. And I said, thanks for
it. It is going to be a long bus ride home. They don't rally. I'll say that. I'll put. Not exactly. And welcome back to the broadcast here live on YouTube. The Riveters trailing the Whale by a score of 2-0. The Whale only have one win on the season. That came on the road. They're trying to win their first home game, quote-unquote. They are the home team, although they'd rather win one in front of their fans for their first official home win, but they want to finish this one off. And we said this, and we're both taking the bus back with the Riveters. The Riveters don't rally in this game, and it's going to be a really long bus ride, while the Whale taking the same ride back up to Stanford, that's going to feel like a breeze if this score stays the same.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's just tough, right? You don't want to come out on the road, you know, especially several hours. We mentioned that the players were on the ice with some of the junior NWHL players, and to come here and not really execute the game plan as you would have liked is tough. With that said, I think both teams will probably look to get some rest on the road, given that they got in yesterday in the evening. We're on the ice again with the juniors, and, you know, it's back to a work week on Monday.
The Riveters arrived here yesterday at 7 o'clock at night. Less than 24 hours later, had to play a game. They will have a meal after this game is over. They'll sign autographs. They'll still be here. Eventually, we'll get on a bus. We'll drive all the way back to New Jersey. They'll get into New Jersey, let's say, around between 2 and 3 a.m. Then they'll get to their respective homes, and then we'll have to go to work on Monday morning. The Whale, the exact same thing, except they're going to be going to Stanford, except instead of going to Newark, which is even further away. And it's just, you got to give credit to these players for doing that time and time again, taking these long bus rides. And usually you have one team that's home and one. Both these teams have to do that, and then they have to go to work on Monday morning at their respective jobs. You just have to have a lot of respect for what these teams are doing here this weekend. And the Whale trying to hold on to this 2-0 advantage. Power play still on for another minute. And as Dan Rice noted on Twitter, that is the first time ever Rebecca Russo's ever taken a penalty. And it's probably one she'd like back, just trying to, you know, get something going, and slashed Rice in on her glove hand as Brickner loses it and has to play it back to center.
That's right. In three seasons, this is the first time Russo has been sent to what we know as the sin bin. So the Riveters now are going to have to really pull something out, get this kill, and get back on track.
Well, with a 2-0 lead, Rogers scoring in the first period about 4 minutes in, and then Mirzova scoring with about 6 minutes to go in the second period to make it 2-0. So that top line for the Whale has been dangerous the last few games and has proven out today. Fluke tries to make a pass down low. Another shot in on Fitzgerald, able to make the stop. 19:09 to go here in this third period, and 11 seconds to go on the power play for Connecticut. They are 0-2 on the power play so far today.
And just taking a look at the social media threads here, it looks like it is a 7-2 score in Minnesota. That's with the road team Boston up 7-2 on the Whitecaps.
The Whitecaps made a statement by winning their first six games, which is the second longest streak for a team in its inaugural season. The Whale actually have that record. They started their franchise 8-0 and actually 11-1. So the Whale will have that record until potentially another expansion team. Russo out of the penalty box moves in, has it taken away again, at least into the corner. Grushow in front. Packer goes around, makes a pass to Dostal. Dostal's shot did not get through. Gets it back at the circle. Now down low to Russo. And the Riveters will get regrouped. Power play is over, obviously, with Russo out of the box. And a power play coming up for the Riveters. Orlando will touch up. And with a minute 31 gone by in the third, the Riveters have a power play coming up. And the Riveters still down on the ice being tended to by teammates.
I'm pretty certain that's Kira Dosdal. She hit the ice and grabbed toward her face. She's able to come off the ice under her own power, so we'll keep an eye out on that as alternate captain Kira Dosdal, one of the original Riveters, is now being looked at on the bench.
So the power play coming up as Barabow goes off to the box. Riveters are 0-2, trying to make it 1-3. If they can, they'll be right back in this one. So Barabow called for the high sticking. Players trying to dig the puck out. Three Whale players and three Riveters players. And finally, the whistle blows. The referees had enough of watching that exercise, and they'll have a face-off coming up. But as I mentioned, the Whale still holding on to that best start to a season by a first-year franchise, winning their first eight games in that first season. But the Boston Pride clearly making a statement in two games in Minnesota. They are a team to be reckoned with. And they'll be playing the Riveters next week in New Jersey for the first time this year. Burke takes a shot, deflected, rebound in front. Oh, it's right there, and it could not be finished. And Raisinen ends up covering the puck. And Burke, looking to the heavens, cannot believe that that shot could not be potted on a rebound. Russo and Richards were right there in front.
And it looked like what happened is Russo was there, and I'm not exactly sure who hit whose skates, but they kind of got in each other's way and were kind of whacking at each other's skates instead of the puck. Just, again, some unfortunate puck luck right in front of net for the Riveters.
Ryan takes another shot and goes wide. And Packer gets it over to Burke. Burke now to Ryan. Ryan across Packer. Burke takes a shot, blocked. And here come the Whale to clear it out. Burke will at least slow it down. But Beatty on her horse chasing after Burke. Under 17 and a half minutes to go in the third period. Under a minute to go on the power play. Burke stick handles through the neutral zone. Has got plenty of space. Moves in. Waits. Puck is right there sitting in the slot. And no one was there to slam it on net. And Fitzgerald comes out of her net. And will stick handle and wait. Oh, very dangerous. Nearly a turnover. But able to find Dench, who slams it off the boards to Grushow. Dench drives to the net. Grushow goes wide. Hits it off the boards to herself. And the Riveters will get reset up. 30 seconds to go on the power play. Dostal waits. Finds Dench. Dostal again. Nearly lost it off her stick. And Dostal surveys. Dench waits. Pass across, looking for the backdoor play. And Dench has it. Takes another shot. Blocked. Dench will get it back again. 10 seconds to go. Another block shot. Dostal. Another block shot. Merzova with back-to-back block shots. And now she'll clear the zone. She can score, she can kill on the penalty, she can do it all, and takes a shot on Fitzgerald for good measure. Lovenjelm's shot has blocked the Whale, kill off another big penalty.
Mrazova's going to have some black and blues that match that Whale uniform there.
That was an impressive display, to say the least. Barebo out of the penalty box, moves in on Fitzgerald, there's a shot, it's loose right at the side of the net, and Zadie able to clear the crease. Zadie does a good job moving it up ice. Can she get to Lewicki? She can. Lewicki with Dench trying to drive down the middle. It's intercepted. Riveters go off for a change. And Ryan has the puck. Ryan gets across the blue line. Barely. No, did not. It was offsides with 15:52 to go. Let's go back to Merzova for a second. Obviously a sniper, the top center on the Whale, but right there showing off the chops, blocking two huge shots.
At least two. I mean, there are a lot of block shots that were there. Looks like maybe she's being tended to a little bit. But again, that's the kind of team play, that's the kind of Connecticut Whale style of play that we're starting to see develop right in front of our eyes here, Matt.
Ryan, a shot that did not get through, was actually intercepted before it got to Raisinen. And now another shot in, and Raisinen able to cover. 15:38 to go here in the second period. The Connecticut Whale, and I'm risking the broadcast jinx, but stat's a stat. The Whale have actually never had a shutout in the regular season. They do have a shutout in franchise history, and it was in their first ever playoff game. Jamie Leonoff shut out Buffalo 2-0 in game one of the 15-16 playoffs. So they do have a shutout in franchise history, but not in the regular season. They're 15 minutes away from doing just that. The Riveters would like to change it up as quickly as possible. Puck sent down, and the Riveters will chase after it. It'll be Burke to get there first. Burke finds Russo, and Russo moves it up to Packer. Packer off the boards. Martian lost her stick, but Lovenjelm gets back to play it, works it around the boards, but Ryan able to keep in, takes a shot, deflected over the crossbar. There's still a loose stick on the ice from Martian, who got a stick from Houston, who's now able to pick up that loose stick. So everybody has got all the equipment that they could need, and the Whale will move it up ice. Lovenjelm turns it over to Dostal, but again, forcing the Riveters all the way back. And we'll see how Ryan Iquale has his team play this, as it's an offside as Menegan was in the zone when she touched the puck. We'll see how Ryan Iquale wants to play this. 2-0 lead. Here comes the cliche. Most dangerous lead in hockey. Yeah. We've heard that a million times. But how do you think Ryan Iquale wants his team to play with this multiple goal lead in the third?
keep playing the way they've been playing. You do not take your foot off the gas. Not against this team, not when you have the momentum, not when you're going to continue to be on the road after this game. They still need a win. They're, as you mentioned, really trying to get out of that basement and have some separation from fifth place. They need to keep doing exactly what they're doing.
Points in two straight games. Remember, they got the point in the shootout loss last week, and trying to get five out of a possible 6 points against the Riveters. The next time these two teams will play would be January 6th. That's going to be the only time these two teams play in Connecticut, in Stanford, in the first weekend of January. Richards tried to force the puck into the zone, but got stopped right at the blue line, and Doyle will just simply dump it in, and both teams will make changes. 14 minutes to go here in the second period. 2-0, the Riveters trailing this one. They were shut out earlier this year by Amanda Levier and the Whitecaps, trying to avoid a second shutout this season. Rysonen plays it behind the net, Lewicki chasing after it. But it was Brickner who got there first, and now Mirzova brings in. Sends it across to Fluke. Fluke on the backhand, moves in, pass across, and Rogers was open, looking for her second goal of the game, but it hopped off her stick at the last second. Now Morse with Lewicki, 2-on-2. Morse goes wide to the far side. On the backhand, stops on the dime and gets it back to Picard. Picard over to Burke, who just joined the play. Burke moves in, takes a shot. It's deflected loose at the side of the net, and a stop made by Rice, and his arm brew was right there at the side of the crease. Fluke gets a pass from Mirzova, back to Mirzova from Fluke. Sends it across, and it's going to be a turnover as Picard gets there. Picard moves it across the red line. Armbrew and Morse join her, but joined her a little too soon. It's an offside, 12:54 to go here in period number three.
Yeah, that was an easy one to call out there. And we were talking about the little things, Mrazova blocking shots in front, multiple shots. It's also the little things, though, on the Riveters that we're seeing, just, you know, not able to stay on sides and things, so they're going to have to clean that up a lot going into the remainder of this third period.
Russo shot, gloved by Rysonen, and she holds on to it. That shot was going to go high off the glass. That was not going to be on frame, but Rysonen, not taking any chances, just gloved it and gives her team another faceoff try. And again, the Whale, and I've noticed this a couple times, because they're able to make that last change, they wait to see who the Riveters have got on the ice, and then they make the change. So Ryan Aquale taking advantage of that last change opportunity with this being designated a home game for the Whale. Burke moves into the slot, sends it back to Packer. Packer, pass across! And Russo was stick checked before it got all the way through. Again, good defensive play by the Whale. Rogers had the puck just escape her grasp, and the Riveter is able to regain control. And a turnover, Doyle in on a breakaway. Shannon Doyle in, she scores! What a move! Shannon Doyle just faked Fitzgerald out of her skates! And with 12:18 to go, Connecticut now leads it 3-0.
Absolute brilliant individual play by Shannon Doyle. She had her head up. I believe that was Rebecca Russo looking to make a pass, not able to connect with her teammate, and gave Shannon Doyle all kinds of space and time to select her move, almost essentially on a breakaway there, and make the most of it. And unfortunately, Fitzgerald was unable to get that stop, and the Whale go up 3-0.
The veteran defender, Shannon Doyle, had the game winner 2 weeks ago, gets the turnover from Russo, and with just a filthy move right at the last second, gets Fitzgerald out of position and is able to score unassisted her second goal of the year.
And I alluded to the Kelly Stedman celly. You know, that's a very fierce celly, two fist pump type celly. I don't know, I kind of like the Shannon Doyle celly. Both arms raised, jump right off the ice. That was very exciting. Shannon Doyle again with a big goal against these Metropolitan Riveters.
And the Connecticut Whale with a 3-0 lead. They played here a year ago and fell to Buffalo in a high-scoring game, and they are having a much better night so far, and the Riveters, with under 12 minutes to go, are in big trouble. Dench on the backhand finds Grushow. And now Dench along the goal line tries to bring it out in front, and it's blocked. Another good play there by Lovenhjelm. Shot in on Rysonen, and she'll just waffle board that one into the corner. Grushow sends it over to Dench. Now Richards. Richards pass across a dangerous one. The shot in on Raisinen goes wide of the net. And the Riveters with a solid answer to that third goal, but they've got to get goals and they got to get them quickly. Zadie can't keep in, and a chance for a two-on-one. It's Menegan and Hewson. Menegan in, waits, pass across to Hewson, and Picard able to stick check that away from Hewson. If she wasn't, that would have been 4-0.
Shelley Picard showing why she's a veteran and an Olympian there.
Dench gains his own while her teammates go off for a change. Allows Connecticut to put two players on. Now pass over to Lawler, has it taken away. And let's see if Ryan can keep in. She does for the moment, but the Whale able to kick that one out. Now Fluke moves in with space, gets stick checked from behind by Lawler. But Fluke and the offense able to recover for the moment. Lawler, oh, nice play there to get it out of the zone. Russo sends it out of the reach of Packer, and that is an icing with 10:24 to go here in the third period, and Connecticut with a 3-0 lead.
And we talked about it a little. You asked Matt what the Connecticut team needed to do, knowing they were up at the time 2-0. I say the same thing I said now that they're up 3-0. Have to keep your foot on the gas. This Riveters team, if they are indeed frustrated, which is understandable, and if they're willing to and able to have a comeback, then they're going to be a dangerous team for the next 10 minutes.
And the thing that's concerning for the Riveters, besides the individual result of today's game, as Russo will bring up, and we'll get back to that point in a second, as Russo tries to get a pass off and could not for the moment. Good pressure again from Connecticut. They've played the most games in the league. So the problem is that other teams have games in hand. While the Riveters have been losing games, or at least not even forcing overtime to get points, they lose today, they'll be 2-7, they'll have 4 points. Connecticut would pass them, they'd have 5. But Connecticut, well, they have played only 6 games after this one. The Riveters have played 9, so the Whale would have 3 games in hand against 3 great opponents. It wouldn't be easy for the Whale to just go and beat Minnesota, Boston, or Buffalo, and they've already struggled against the Buttes already this year and lost to Boston too. But still, that is a lot of games in hand. So the Riveters, not only are falling behind in the standings, they're falling behind in the games played category, or at least they're jumping out ahead, which they don't want to be doing right now, but they can't control that part of it at least.
Yes, that's a very important point. And also, the road is not necessarily getting easier for the Riveters, as they will have a few more games with Boston. We see what they're doing against the Whitecaps, the top team in the league at the present time. And then they play Buffalo. They have several games against the Buffalo Buttes.
Yeah, they have all 4 games. They do not play Buffalo until later in January. They don't play them at home until February. Kind of the odd bit of the scheduling. They played the Whitecaps their first 4 games of the year, and the Whitecaps kind of started them off on a bad note and got themselves started off on a great note. And the Riveters really just haven't been able to recover. And the Whale have certainly made a point today that they are not going to be going away and are not going to allow the Riveters to just blow right by them in the standings. There were low expectations for the Whale coming into this season from a lot of different media experts, but they are proving everybody wrong every step of the way. They might have been blown out against Buffalo, but they gave Boston a run for their money, and they have definitely given the Riveters a run as that pass, or excuse me, that shot is knocked away, and Lewicki just could not catch up there. That was a little bit too hard out of the zone, and Ryson and Comley was able to stick handle. As we are out of the media timeout, 9:45 to go, and that puck looked like it hit off a Riveter player on the bench, and so the faceoff will come outside the zone.
Yeah, and I was keeping an eye out on that because, as we know, Kristen Lewicki has 1 fastest skater, and if anyone could have caught up to that on the ice, you'd have to think it was her. Maybe we'll say Rebecca Russo also, who's had that title in her career as well.
Boston now 5-2 in the season as their win has been locked in the standings. Minnesota 6-2, so the Pride with a sweep of Minnesota this weekend on the road. Now 2 points back of the Whitecaps and have a game in hand, which they will see next week against the Riveters. So the Pride could be tied in the standings at the end of next week with Minnesota halfway through their season. Minnesota 6-2 after 8 games. Grushow takes a shot, save made by Raisinen. Grushow again, who had the best chance for the Riveters in this game, had an open shot, but Raisinen was there to make the stop. Burke down low. Grushow tries to get it back to Burke. Grushow gets it again. Raisinen was down in her crease for a second, and Dench has it. 9 minutes to go here in the third period. Riveters have had big comebacks against the Whale in franchise history before. That was a long time ago, and this is basically a different team than it was when they rallied from a 5-1 deficit against Connecticut back in February of 2017. Good play there again. The captain, Emily Fluke, sitting down on her back and was able to swing that puck in and force Fitzgerald to cover it. I mean, that's just effort right there. There's nothing else to say.
Yep, she found herself tangled there with Madison Packer. We know Madison Packer is big and strong on the ice. As you mentioned, she's falling to the ground and able to just push that puck forward.
Lawler sends it up ice, and Aide will come up and play it. And as we're under 8.5 minutes to go here in the third period. Goals by Rogers, Merzova, and Doyle here in this one. A goal in each period for Connecticut with a 3-0 lead as they're trying to keep the shutout intact for Miri Rison, who is celebrating a birthday. And as I mentioned earlier in the broadcast, went to Robert Morris University, which is not far from this area here in Western Pennsylvania. So kind of like a homecoming for her, celebrating a birthday, and right now trying to pitch the first regular season shutout in Whale franchise history.
She had a pretty nice celly after that first win, too. So if they can hold on and keep an eye out for that.
Morris takes a shot and easy save by Rison, and as it hit the Whale logo on her uniform. 8:09 to go, and an offensive zone faceoff coming up. Grushow wins the faceoff. Burke tries to make a centering pass, and it's intercepted by Connecticut. Goldsmith tries to get it out, and she does. Zadie will chase after it. And as we're under 8 minutes to go here in the third period. Near turnover, Goldsmith tried to get there, but the Riveter is able to force it out the center before it's sent right back in by Brickner, and the Whale will go off for a change. Quickly up ice comes Metropolitan. Richards had it taken away, and the Whale just very patient with it now. 3-0 advantage. Trying not to give the Riveters any hope the rest of this game with 7.5 minutes to go. Battleford in the corner, Orlando and Richards, and it's swung around the other side where Dench goes in there and tries to put a check in on Tiberi. And it's going to be picked up, and here come the Whale. Merzova and Fluke, 2-on-2 with Picard and Dostal, and the shot was blocked, and Fluke was able to get there first. Pass across, nobody home except the Riveter, and Picard, dangerously stick-handling right in front of the net, was able to get away, and will move it up. Dench across the blue line, onside, gets over to Packer. Packer, backdoor pass, looking for Lawler, but again, active sticks for the Whale. Puck sent around. And it'll be cleared out the center. Six minutes and 20 seconds to go here in the third period. And the Whale with a commanding lead. Riveter is looking just for the first, and maybe that'll spark something here. 6 minutes and 10 seconds now to go.
And you know, you asked again about how the Whale would come into this third period. I spent a few minutes just now taking a look at the benches, and you can see Ryan Equali still up, still active, talking to his players that are on the ice, engaging his players on the bench, very much so into this game. So if there was any concern that the Whale would kind of, you know, pump on the brakes a little bit, from what I'm seeing across the ice from Ryan Equali, that is not the case.
He is going to be thrilled with this performance if they can finish off the final 6 minutes. I'll tell you that. This has been maybe the best the Whale have played in a few seasons, that's for sure. Certainly better than anything we saw last year. This has been a complete performance. And again, they're the home team, but we know they're on the road. They played here last year. A lot of these players, it's their first time playing in this facility. And they're playing almost like a perfect road game. Shot in, deflected through. Rison was able to make the stop. It's played behind the net, and it's caught up, and now the Whale will have it. And for the Riveters, again, the storyline in part can be about players not here. Amanda Kessel not able to be here for this game. Kelsey Colzer out with an injury. Did skate on Thursday, but they didn't feel that she was ready to draw back into the lineup, so not in. Of course, Kelly Nash doesn't play road games, so not exactly a surprise there, but she's a big part of this team that's not out there today. And take nothing away from the Whale, but for the Riveters, they just... every time they get a full lineup, it seems like there's something else that comes up that turns it around, and they end up having to use their depth, and the depth has not come through like it did a year ago.
And, you know, it's worth noting that a part of that is hockey. This is a game. This is a sport. Unfortunately, athletes are going to get hurt. But there is another part of that that comes down to strategy and how you're able to utilize what you have and make something of what you have.
Deflection goes through the crease from Richards. But Räisänen just watched it calmly go by. Under 4.5 minutes to go now.
And so just going back to that point, it's just worth noting that there has to come a time where the Riveters are again going to commit to what they're going to do with what they have.
Turnover in the neutral zone, and Martian brings in with space, driving his men again, and it's off the back of her stick. As it's been a counterattack from the Whale in this third period that has fueled their rise here in this game. Under 4 minutes to go now. Played in the neutral zone by Menegan, being harassed by Burke, and Menegan will just calmly send it in deep. And the question might be asked, I'm not the one asking it, but the question might be asked, what will happen with Katie Fitzgerald? Will she get a chance to start next week, or does Randy Velischek decide to go back to Kimberly Sass for a start next week against Boston?
I think it is worth noting, again, in a conversation we had with Randy, that was something that the Riveters team seemed to need to figure out, and that this game would be a part of that conversation.
Fitzy did get her only win of the season against Boston earlier this year up in Boston. It was the Riveters' first win of the year, and Sass got a win last week in the shootout. Penalty coming up. Interference is the call with 3:09 to go, and the Whale will send the Riveters back on the power play. And with a 3-0 lead, we'll see if Randy Velischek decides to pull the goaltender now and try to make it 6-on-4 and try to get back into this game. It seems kind of an odd question to ask, but it's not crazy. 3 goals in 3 minutes is not something that's impossible. And just as we were saying it, Fitzgerald will come off. It's going to be 6-on-4 for the Riveters for at least the next 2 minutes, trailing it by 3.
Now, this does mean, though, that the Riveters are going to have to stay extremely sharp on this power play.
And the Whale can shoot from anywhere on the ice. Icing is not a factor on the penalty kill, as you all know. Burke to Packer. Burke takes a shot, deflected again by Löwenhjelm. A pass to the middle. Löwenhjelm trying to just kick it out, do everything she can to get it out, and she will be able to do so. Burke has to go back to the neutral zone, has to be confident with the puck, and she is. Richards, nice play there to let it go through her legs. Ryan waits. Pass down to Richards, and able to knock down a player in front, but could not get the shot off. Burke has it now. Under 90 seconds to go on the power play. 2:35 to go in the game. Riveters trying to break up the shutout at least. Whale have a chance to shoot on the empty net and try to put the nail in the coffin here. Burke sends it down. Ryan has a shot pass. It's still loose along the goal line, and Russo gets it back. Pass across. Packer has time. Now Burke. Burke nearly lost it, but Packer gets it back. Burke dropped her stick. Good job by Packer to keep it in the zone. Barely did, but was able to do so. Russo to Grushow, takes a shot, saved by Räisänen, and rebound out in front. And it's going to be cleared out of the zone. Under 50 seconds to go here in the power play. And now a whistle behind the play. And it looks like we're going to have another penalty coming up against Connecticut with under 2 minutes to go. It's going to be a 6-on-3 now. No, it's going to be coincidental minor, so not a 6-on-3. It'll be down to a 5-on-3. And looks like Fitzy getting ready to come back onto the ice. We'll see where the faceoff's going to be. And because it's coincidental, I do apologize. Neither team's going to lose any skater power. So minute 56 to go, and a timeout called by the Riveters. As it was Ryan, it looked like, that went to the penalty box for the Riveters. I didn't catch who went to the box for Connecticut.
I believe it's Tiberi in there, Kim Tiberi.
So a pair of fives in the box as the Riveters call a timeout here. So power play defender comes off the ice for the Riveters for the rest of this game because of the coincidental minors. That's it. Ryan's done no matter what happens the rest of this game unless it goes overtime.
Yeah. Going back to that frustration level, it's kind of hard. I feel like we're kind of repeating ourselves here, but it's just you know, time again and again that we're just seeing frustration get the best of the Riveters today. And that's something that they're going to have to clean up. That's something that whatever they can salvage from today and be able to get something past Raisinen, that would be ideal. But moving forward, that's something they're going to have to figure out because, as we mentioned, injuries are part of the game. Injuries have kind of been the name of the game for the Riveters this season. So knowing that going in, again, what is the team, what is the coaching staff saying, and being able to do and show on the ice as far as what the Riveters really want to make for the rest of this season. We know that everyone is going to get into the playoffs, but it's just as much about the standings as it is how they're playing the game and how they're prepping for the postseason.
Pass up to Grushow. Grushow gets taken down, and play will continue. Packer gets it over to Burke. Still 6-on-4. Shot in, save made by Rison, and Richards was looking for the tip but could not get it. With 102 seconds to go, 34 seconds on the power play for the Riveters, before Barbo comes out of the box, and again, Ryan and Tiberi, barring overtime, which would be almost a miracle at this point, they'll be in the box for the rest of the game, at least in regulation play.
Well, we've seen Rebecca Russo get an important goal in that win against Boston with just seconds left on the clock. They're going to need some of that, the Riveters.
They're going to need about three of those. Burke brings it across, waits, still waiting, now sends it down as a shot goes wide. Again, the Riveters trying to break up the shutout. Whale, 90 seconds and counting away from the first regular season shutout in franchise history. Shot blocked. Another shot in. Raisinen with the save. Miri Raisinen, have yourself a day.
Got to think she's one of the contenders for player of the week, at least player first star of this game after her performance again on her birthday. Good job by Zadie, though, to follow up on that deflection. Almost got it past her.
Minute 15 to go. 5 seconds on the power play. Burke has it. Passed down low, but it hit off the skate of Grushow, and the power play is over, and the Riveters, as Barbo came out of the box, almost got a turnover there. Shot behind the net, and Merzova will clear it out. Now icing is a factor, and it's going to be turned over. Barbo has the game on her stick. Game over. Whale are going to win this one. 54.6 to go. 4-0 Connecticut. What a performance today by the Whale, as they're going to vault into fourth place and knock off the Riveters for a second time in 3 weeks.
Barbo comes out of the penalty box, gets into the play, and then the Riveters unable to keep that puck there, and she goes on the break. Empty net goal for the fourth for the Connecticut Whale in front of this crowd at the Lemieux Sports Complex.
So the final 50 seconds, Fitzgerald will re-enter the net. Can't imagine she'll leave that position for the rest of the game. 40 seconds to go. So Barbo scoring her first goal of the season. The second unassisted goal of this period for the Whale after Doyle made it 3-0. It started with Rogers early. Miri Raisinen was on top of her game from the second the whistle blew. And there are 20 seconds remaining. Picard will play it behind. Riveters just trying to break up the shutout here. Morse brings it in. Morse stick handles, waits, takes a shot deflected down. 10 seconds to go. Dostal has it. Shot goes wide. 5 seconds to go. And that will do it for the first time in regular season franchise history. The Connecticut Whale have a shutout. Miri Raisinen on her birthday gets the win, and Connecticut wins it here today in Pittsburgh by a score of 4-0.
Raisinen, Robert Morris alum, jumps for joy just as her teammates come over to congratulate her for her second win, first professional shutout. And again, just an overall good performance, good game by this Connecticut Whale team, who picks up in Pittsburgh a home win.
Their first home win of the season. They will go up to Buffalo next week. And there had been some talk before the game. You said that maybe Sorokina could get a chance to play next week. Might not happen now. You can't sit Raisinen after a shutout. And of course, we're saying only sit because they want to give Sorokina a chance. But Raisinen, not today, pitches the shutout. And I have to expect she'll be between the pipes for the game next week in Buffalo. That's for certain. What a performance today by the Finnish superstar. And this Connecticut Whale team They are not last year's team, that's for certain. As they salute this wonderful crowd, a near sellout crowd here in Cranberry Township just outside Pittsburgh, as the new celebration, as they twirl their sticks above their heads, as they're naming the three stars. Mirzova, the third star. Nina Rogers gets the second star. Of course, she had the game-winning goal officially. And, of course, Raisinen easily the number one star.
Absolutely. And we see there's a nice little relationship that has happened between Merik Raisinen, who salutes the crowd now, and Loan Jelm, of course, for their national teams, that being Finland for Raisinen and Sweden for Loan Jelm. They find themselves as adversaries. But on this Connecticut team, it seems like nothing but love between the two.
Certainly a great performance today by the Whale, and congratulations to Bryson, and once again celebrating a shutout on her birthday. On the other side of the coin, the Riveters fall today 4-0. Excuse me, couldn't even get that out. They fall today 4-0. And as I mentioned, it's going to be a long, long bus ride from Western Pennsylvania back to New Jersey for this team. They're 2-7, and it's getting late early.
It's getting late early indeed. This is a Riveters team that they're going to really have to go back to the drawing board. I don't know that there's much that they're going to be pleased about that they were able to do consistently over three periods of hockey. That in and of itself is going to be a challenge to overcome. Of course, we've talked about the injuries. And as you mentioned, now they're running out of time. They're running out of games. Again, the upside perhaps is that every team makes the playoffs. So there's time to get Riveters hockey back on track. But they're going to have to dig themselves out of a hole if they want to be, you know, a proper contender and defend their 2018 Isabel Cup.
The next games for these two teams, Connecticut will travel up to Buffalo on Saturday, December 8th. That game will start at 6 o'clock. And the Riveters will be home on Sunday, December 9th. That is going to be the Twitter game of the week. Well, they'll be playing host to the Boston Pride. For Eric Ayala, I am Matt Falkenberry. Thanks for joining us on the broadcast today. Your final score, once again, the Connecticut Whale 4 and the Metropolitan Riveters 0. Thank you for joining us here on YouTube. Until next time, have a great night, everybody.